Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Identity Insights by Indicio. I am your host, Tim Spring. Today, I'm joined by Mike Vesey, CEO of IDRAMP, and he's here to discuss their approach to zero trust identity orchestration. Thanks again for joining me today, Mike. Would you mind starting us off with a little bit of about you?
Sure, my pleasure. Happy to be here. Yeah, I'm an old school identity guy. I've been around forever and been working on enterprise identity solutions and federation and all things of that nature since really the early 2000s. So the last 20 years, I've really focused on how organizations see identity, use identity, and I've grown and evolved through all the different camps, through federation, and then as of late, the past 5 or 6 years, decentralized identity really, as we all know, is kind of the future of where we're going. And we focused hard to build some of that technology into our products and services. So really excited to be here and talk a little bit more about it.
All right, awesome. And you kind of touched on it there a little bit with, you know, the federated versus decentralized. Could you break down those terms for me real quick and just, how sure. What do those mean?
Sure. Yeah. So in the early 2000s, right, this was SAML was just kind of getting its start. And that was a technology that would allow an organization to say, I want to use this cloud service, right? That's when all these cloud services started jumping into the market, and they're still, going today, going strong. And the idea of, do we create another username and password for every service we want to utilize? Or is there some way that I can use the infrastructure that I have invested in, my directory of employees or users, to pass into that service the login credentials? That's federation. So that's single sign-on. So we say we want to provide one set of credentials to log into all of these different relying party services, if you will. And those are just everyday common services that we all use. So that was a really big problem in the early 2000s because we had these enterprises, really big multinational enterprises, and new products would come on the scene. I remember one that was particularly challenging was Microsoft Live Meeting back in the day. That was the predecessor to Zoom, Teams, all of the great tools that are out there for collaboration today. Microsoft Live Meeting was the very first one of those that had the ability to pass through a corporate firewall seamlessly. Right. So that was a really big deal because before that, it was, boy, there was just an awful lot of work that we had to do, to get these collaborative tools working. And it, because there was so much friction, nobody used them. But when Live Meeting came on the scene, it was the explosion of this industry. And they were going to market to their customers saying, OK, all you have to do to use Live Meeting is create a username and password. And then you can start using it. So an organization that has 25,000-50,000 employees, it's a help desk nightmare, right? So that's really where we got started with single sign-on and federation, where these types of services came in. The enterprise said, we refuse to have our 25,000 employees create a different username and password because it will all come back to us when they forget them and it'll be a support nightmare. So we needed to devise a way where that service could take the identity already defined within that organization and pass it in. Thus the birth of single sign-on and federation. So it grew and it grew rapidly. And we started seeing things like organizations like Microsoft and Google and Facebook, when they came on the scene saying, okay, we've got your solution. We're just going to allow everybody that can get into our platform to log in. And that was kind of the birth of OAuth, right? And this new way of doing a federation with these third-party providers that carried these identities. Did it ease the friction? A little bit. It was a little bit easier for the user. They didn't have to remember all these passwords. But from a security and privacy perspective, it's kind of a nightmare. Right now, we're saying, okay, Facebook knows about every interaction I have when I log into my other, my Live Meeting service, for example, or something like that. It really created the whole business of surveillance capitalism and all the stuff that we've heard so many negative things about. It's because we were trying to remove that friction from the login process and make it easier and better secured for the end user of these services. So fast forwarding, to decentralization, that is a whole different concept, which I'm sure we'll talk about a little bit more here, but that's really the idea where I bring my own identity, right? I bring an identity that I have that is valid to me, and I can interact with these services with a lot less structure than we have in a federated world. And in the worst case, in an enterprise, some of this is still being done today. When we federate these big directories, take merger and acquisition, for example, two companies come together, we're merging all of those user accounts into one massive directory. The worst version of that is if we're just partnering with another organization and we do that, over-entitlement is running rampant in that scenario. And how do we ever unwind that, right? The answer is we generally don't. So then you have this governance nightmare, you know, where you're trying to track and control all the stuff that has happened. So decentralization really is the solution to that. It allows me to use my assets to do whatever service I want to do. And if I partner with somebody else, they use their own identity assets to bring that in. Identity orchestration is really the culmination of that. In my mind, it's that ultimate flexibility to tie together whatever identity source you may want, whether it's a corporate directory, a self-sovereign identity, a decentralized identity generated from, you know, a document scan, selfie match, whatever. I don't care what it is. It's the ability to use those to facilitate service delivery. Ever important for the enterprise, right? It's incredibly important that they remain flexible and agile enough to implement these new technologies and new solutions as they come onto the scene. And they are doing so at an ever-increasing rate.
Okay. Thank you. That's very good to know. So you touched on it a little bit there in your answer, but what is identity orchestration? If you could really just break that down for us in terms of what it like looks like, maybe both technically and from a user perspective.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that specifically because we're at a point in the market right now where we're running the risk of identity orchestration becoming, air quotes, blockchain, right? When you walk into a room with 10 people and you say blockchain and ask them what you mean, you'll get 10 different responses. Everybody thinks of it as a different type of technology, right? So identity orchestration is getting dangerously close to that right now because there's so many organizations that are selling some version of that. To me, identity orchestration is that flexibility. It's the ability for me to say, the world is full of disparate identities. I need a way to leverage those and incorporate those in my service delivery flow, whatever that flow is. If it means logging into a service without a password, awesome. That's a great use case. If it means physical access to a building, awesome. That's a great use case. We're not here to define the use cases. We're here to make sure that no matter what those identities are, and they can be biometric, they can be, I mean, we don't care, right? They can be any form or flavor. We just want to make sure that you can use those in your business practice to solve whatever problem it is you're trying to solve. I know that's a little rambly, but I really think that, you know, identity orchestration is just that ultimate flexibility.
Okay. No, absolutely. I appreciate that answer. You know, I know IDRAMP is fairly new on the scene, right? And I was curious, you know, is this the problem that you set out to solve specifically? Could you talk a little bit about IDRAMP and like why it came together?
Yeah, you know, it is, but it was a long path, right? The original problem we set out to solve was giving an organization a single pane of glass. And wow, is that not true, right? Everybody that's listening right now is laughing because I've never in my life seen a single pane of glass solution, but it definitely reduces the number of layers that you have to manage when trying to manage complex things around service delivery in an enterprise. So we have to think about things like consent management, you know, terms and conditions, conditional rules. Okay, you're accessing this service, but if you access from Germany, you need a separate policy. You need a separate set of requirements than if you join from Canada. And so, you know, being able to provide that magic in the middle was really the problem that IDRAMP set out to solve. Decentralization kind of came on the scene you know, as we evolved and found that even with that simplified solution, we were still challenged with this really complex flow from our, you know, end users, from our ultimate customers, the consumer of those products and services. and decentralization techniques, even if it's just, as I mentioned, you know, using a something that we already have in place, like a directory, but maybe we just issue a credential or some kind of a token that user can take away and bring back as proof. It just simplifies everything. It makes everything cheaper. Our IAM resources go down, you know, so it really makes things, it's a better way to build the solution. And that piece kind of came on after we started our original vision. The original IDRAMP message was pretty simple. You know, we just want to help add velocity and simplify the flow of services within an organization. And decentralization is really helping us do that in a better way at the enterprise pace, right? They don't have to do an all-in-one. It's not a forklift. It's just a very natural thing. And it's also helping us expand the market and getting it down to the organizations who really need it, which is the mid-tier businesses. You know, the small and medium-sized businesses really don't have the ability today to use these types of advanced techniques because they're usually at the higher end of the cost scale with some of the cloud service providers. So really excited about that. And we're just starting to see that area really ramp up as public sector now post-COVID is focusing more on decentralized verifiable IDs. And that's another key point, Tim, for anybody that may have missed this in the intro. Decentralization is happening around you every day and you know about it. You just may not associate it with the terms. I guarantee if you're in the US, you've heard about your state talking about a decentralized mobile driver's license. That's a decentralized identification. Europe has their EBSI initiative. They have a European identity. I know Germany and a bunch of other countries already have identities generated for their citizens. These are all decentralized identities. They're all going to converge and collide. And we're going to have to figure out, as enterprise business owners, we're going to have to figure out how to use those. How are we going to do that? I would argue identity orchestration or tools like IDRAMP are going to be the answer to that. You can't expect your internal IAM system to be that dynamic and flexible to be able to accept 50 unique state government IDs in the US, plus everything that's going to come out of Europe. You're going to need somebody that hyper-focuses on the inclusion of those digital IDs and will allow you to retrofit those into your existing service delivery flows because it's just too disruptive to try and build those into each product independently.
All right. No, that totally makes sense. You would want someone, for lack of a better term, in my mind, is kind of like checking IDs at the door, right? And knowing which ones are the ones to use.
That's great. No, you're exactly right. It is that. It's a lightweight, the verification on the edge or in the middle or however we want to state it. It really provides. And it's not a replacement, right? I know we'll get into this, I'm sure, but this, we're not at all advocating that identity orchestration or the IDRAMP tools are in any way a replacement of anything that you have today in your current infrastructure. You still need your current IAM. This is really just a better logic engine, right? It's a better, smarter engine for processing these disparate things that are going to come at you and allowing you to save. You're actually going to reduce cost by eliminating a lot of the manual work that needs to be done to build those policies and enforce those policies. So there is a governance play here as well, right? There's a lot of governance built into this solution. And that's something that the enterprise is keen on right now because there's an incredible amount of money that's wasted every year just trying to manage and maintain the ever-increasing identity footprint within the organization.
Absolutely. So there, right, you kind of touched on some real-world use cases, right, the digital IDs for mobile driver's licenses and stuff that a lot of states are looking into. Are there any examples in the real world of, you know, IDRAMP in action that you can point to and say like, hey, this is what it does and how it does it kind of thing?
Sure. Yeah, there's a bunch. And all of us in this space that are focusing on orchestration, decentralization, we need more people to embrace the simple use cases so that we can start really, you know, proving out the technology is better, you know, or it's a better, easier way. And I don't mean better technologically advanced or anything like that. It's all of that stuff. But this comes down to dollars and cents. It can save you money. And it can provide a higher level of assurance that you are interacting with the same, you know, people that you think you're interacting with. And that's where I'd like to draw some attention to some of the solutions that are out there. First and foremost, a really progressive partner, and they're kind of a distributed cloud virtual meeting platform. They're called KikoChat. They do the Internet Identity Workshop, and were really instrumental during COVID. They do support today in their platform a way that you can log in with your personal identity. And that's really cool, right? It's simple. It's just you verify your email address and they give you a verifiable credential that says, this is you, but then that is a unique token to just you. And you can use that when you go back to log in. So really impressive work that they're doing there. We also have a product that we actually created called Bouncer, and that is a virtual Zoom protection event. So it allows you to secure every attendee inside a Zoom meeting using some type of credential. And that, again, it can be a simple email two-factor. It can be a verifiable credential generated by proving out your email address. It can be a biometric signature from a doc scan selfie. I mean, it can be as simple or as complex as you want, but the end result is it's not a simple link that you can forward out to 100,000 people, right? So it protects the event. You know, when you get into that event, that the people that are getting into that event have been vetted in some way, even if it's as simple as, you know, a two-factor email, and it's up to you as a host to create those rules. That product is pretty cool. I think we're going to see a tremendous growth in the next year or two around verified virtual meeting participants. And we're really excited to kind of lead out some of the technology behind that. So some of our partners, you know, we've got some big enterprise customers that are doing some solutions as well. Ironically, it's around one of the first solutions you're going to hear about is doing that very thing. It's using a verified identity to access a virtual meeting platform. In this case, it's not a Zoom, but it's more of an enterprise grade tool that they use to reach tens of thousands of potential, you know, customers or employees every month. And they want to provide some level of identity assurance in those interactions. So we're partnering to provide a solution like that to them to bake into their product that they use, their webcasting product. And so that's a very exciting thing coming as well. We're happy to support that. And there's many others that I could talk on probably forever, but those are some of the most unique first use cases.
No, absolutely. That's very cool. So we are coming to the end of our time here. So I just want to ask you just one more question, which is what's next for IDRAMP? Is there anything for 2023? And you talked about it a little bit already, right, with the increased meeting verification. Mm-hmm. But is there any other products or, you know, things that we could be on the lookout for?
Yeah, I think, we have good support across the decentralized community, right? We have on the IDRAMP platform, we have today the ability to federate any identity source, any relying party using, you know, its traditional federated protocols like SAML/OAuth, OIDC, things like that. We've also baked in verifiable credentials into that. So we support verifiable credentials on the Indicio network, of course, on any other Hyperledger in the Aries network. We also have full support for Microsoft Entra. So issue verification on the Entra side. And then, you know, biometrics. So I would say what's next is we're really focusing now on the integration and the implementation of those technologies. For the past couple of years, the market has been busy. You know, we've been busy working on the products and solutions. I really think 2023 is going to be a year where we start putting some rubber on the road within enterprise organizations. I think they've read about decentralization. We now have, Gartner, Coventry Cole, Forrester, all talking about decentralization segments in their identity strategies. So enterprise will start spending money. And I would like to think that they're going to start spending money by finding tools that can help them migrate from their existing legacy systems to a more decentralized strategy without rip and replace, you know, maximizing the investment that they already have And just building that whole message out and starting to deliver those products is really what is what's on our roadmap for this year.
All right. Sounds good. Well, it looks like that is the end of our time. Thank you so much for joining me here, Mike. If you at home are interested in verifiable credential technology or, you know, learning more about decentralized zero trust, please be sure to subscribe to the channel. We'll be continuing to bring you some more educational content in the future. If you have any questions or specific topics that you'd like for us to cover, please go ahead and leave a comment below and we'll be sure to read and address them. Thank you again, Mike. If people want to learn more about IDRAMP or what you've been up to, where would you suggest they go to learn more?
Yeah, thanks, Tim. If people want to talk to us, please reach out at IDRAMP.com. It's IDRAMP.com. A lot of good recorded information out there. You can subscribe to our newsletter. So please reach out. We love talking to people and would love to talk about your projects.